You and your co-founder have a deep history of building infrastructure for the Indian financial ecosystem, you know, whether it was through GST, APIs, or through Beam, or through your, in general, volunteer work at iSpirit. So tell us about your origin story. What inspired you and Nikhil, your co-founder, to build Setu?
That's a great question, Gautam. Nikhil and I actually met in 2016, early 2016, right around the time UPI's technical launch was happening. And we were introduced to each other by Nandan Nilekani, who I had worked with earlier when I was at Aadhaar back in 2010. And of course, I was part of the kind of core team around the India stack, working around building out eKYC, eSign, or at least designing these public digital platforms. And Nandan actually introduced us in 2016, saying that this is, this is a time for us to kind of get together and get UPI to 100 million users in 18 months. And those are the kind of targets that only Nandan can set. So maybe useful at that point to give a little bit of background into what Nikhil was also doing then. So Nikhil began his career at Tally and then was at Intuit and then at Exotel. So he'd done a lot of work in both small business software and also around APIs. And so he had back then just joined the India Stack team to head the developer ecosystem for India Stack. And specifically, he was tasked with building out the ecosystem for UPI. I myself, back then in 2016, was a VC where I was focusing on fintech and what we call mass market technology or tech for Bharat. But my colleagues at the fund were kind enough to let me spend about 20% of my time working on India Stack, where I was a volunteer. And my job was primarily working on strategy, working on figuring out the economics for these platforms, and also being a bit of an evangelist or a spokesperson on both TV and other kind of media and conferences, etc. And essentially being the kind of evangelist saying that there is still a vision for India Stack where we would export digital infrastructure, just like China does a lot of exporting of physical infrastructure, that we would work with other countries to take some of these pioneering innovations that we've taken on public digital platforms to other countries. So Nikhil and I met each other in that context of building out the ecosystem for UPI. And we became very close friends during that time. We practically became brothers. UPI went through a very exciting time where back in early 2016, if you actually go through some of the media coverage, then there was a lot of skepticism. There was a lot of questions around why do we need another payment system platform. And obviously now in retrospect, a lot of those questions have been answered and then some. But back then, building that ecosystem was our primary job. And we became, like I said, really, really good friends. It was an exciting time. 2016 was also the year demonetization happened. And while a lot of things went wrong with demonetization, one of the positive externalities of that particular event was that digital payments and digitization in general received quite a bit of a boost. And then Nikhil, at that point, was part of the team that led the build-out of the Beam application. And he led the team that got that app built in 3 weeks. Following demonetization. At that point, I was working with the Chief Economic Advisor's office, figuring out how long it would take for India to return its cash to its people and things like that. That was an exciting time, and we became very close. And around 2018, when I was thinking of moving on from my VC gig, it became very clear that, to me at least, that, needed to build another company. And for me, partly that's the reason behind that is that I come from a business family. I'm a fourth generation entrepreneur. My great
That's
grandfather, my
amazing.
grandfather, my father all started their own businesses, all small businesses, but entrepreneurship
Just
really was
that
always
the
the
thing was always in your
it's
bloodline of sorts.
yeah,
That
I
spirit was
mean
always there.
one way of saying it is that it's the default option for people like us. So it became very clear that I had just become a dad earlier in the year. And then you start asking yourself fairly existential questions when you become a father. And one of them was, if I've always wanted to be a founder and be and start my own company, and if I haven't done so, then I couldn't in good conscience encourage my son to go
Follow the family path.
and or at least pursue whatever it is that was his calling. And so I decided to kind of start a company, and I had learned enough in my experience that who you work with matters far more than what you work on. And Nikhil was one of those people that, like I mentioned earlier, grown very close to. And he was the kind of person that I would have happily bet the fund on when I was a VC. So since there was both a values match and there was obviously a lot of faith that I had and respect that I had for his abilities, I knew that he's the person that I would have to kind of start a business with. And so we got to kind of jamming about different business ideas. And initially, it wasn't necessarily very clear. And in hindsight, it appears kind of obvious that the two of us would have started this kind of a company. But it wasn't obvious to us when we first started talking about it. But I think, the more we talked, the more it became very clear that for us, the happiest times and the most fulfilling periods of our career was when we built infrastructure for for digital platforms, right? When we built these large scale systems that millions of people or hundreds of millions of people would
Exactly.
use.
Scalable architecture.
Pretty much, yes. And for me, my idols were people like Visveshwaraya, people like E. Sridharan, who built the
The metro
Delhi Metro,
bus system.
and of course Nandan, who was the architect of Aadhaar and several other platforms. And these are all, essentially engineers who built infrastructure that tens, if not hundreds of millions of people use on a daily basis. And that's the largest impact you can have on people's lives. So when we started thinking about what kind of impact we wanted to have, it became very clear that, one, we wanted to build infrastructure that would materially improve the quality of life of our of Indians at the very least to begin with, and hopefully a much broader impact. And when you look at, what is it that will drive GDP growth for the country, and what is it that will improve the quality of life? So when we start thinking about what are the vectors that will drive GDP growth for the country, we know that healthcare is a very important vector, education is a very important vector, urbanization is a very important vector. But Nikhil and I are not experts in either of these sectors. So we know that a fourth and a very important vector is financialization or financial inclusion, broadening of the net of formal finance, so to speak. And that is, we think, one of those key underpinning layers of society. And for us, the mission was, if you're going to improve the quality of life of these people, the first thing that you should make sure is that Lakshmi is resident in every home, there is wealth in every home.
Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us for this episode. The Indian Art Podcast is available on YouTube, Apple Music, Spotify, and Google Podcasts. Be sure to follow us on Instagram and Facebook to receive all updates on the upcoming episodes. We'll see you in the next one. Thank you.